All right, thank you very much. So as my project says, this is a survey of biochars. And every time when I talk about my project, I like to give the context of why we're doing this research. And the first question is, well, why are we studying biochar and what's my perspective? And since we're an ag university and that's my kind of my research area, we are investigating biochar in agriculture. I mean, there's been a lot of research that's shown that when there's crop production or increased crop production or decreased crop production in with biochar amended soils, there's an interaction with nutrients. So we want to look at the direct interactions with nutrients, and this also helps out. This can also be beneficial for engineered applications such as bioreactors, which you can see up there. So the next question then is, why are we doing a survey? And really, the main reason is because there's currently no consensus, I mean, as we're seeing in all these presentations, on biochar production or use. There's many different ways people are using it, and then the results are different too. There's increases and there's decreases in production. And this survey allows us to kind of quickly take a look at a whole bunch of biochars and see if there is a direct interaction with nutrients that could be beneficial for plants or possibly lead to a mechanism that's beneficial to plants. So with that, we will go to my experimental method. And what we did is a batch equilibrium of a global collection of biochars, which included hardwood biochars, pine biochars, activated charcoal, and we just wanted to get everything. We had them produced in different ways, so fast pyrolysis, slow pyrolysis, and microwave-assisted pyrolysis, some hydrothermal char, so there were a lot of them. And what we did was we put these biochars in centrifuge tubes with solutions of either ammonia, nitrate, or phosphate. And that's the concentrations up there. So 20 ppm is actually 20 milligrams per liter. And they were done in triplicates. So they were shaken for 24 hours, and then we analyzed them with our Latchet quick chem instrument, which is pictured up there. Our results are kind of interesting. I mean, we got all over the spectrum with biochars. And this is our equation. So our percent sorption is basically the starting concentration minus the ending concentration divided by the starting concentration. That gives you a percentage. Multiply it by 100. And as you can see, I mean, there are some biochars that absorbed a lot of ammonia. All of the ammonia. Some of it absorbed most of the nitrate, and some, absorbed most of the phosphate. And just so you know, my working definition of absorption is really just the removal of these nutrients from solution. And then we had a mean that was more reasonable. I mean, 38 for ammonia, 13 for nitrate, and 22% for phosphate. And then what we also saw is that there were actually charcoals that added ammonia, nitrate, or phosphate to solution. We had a lot of charcoals actually that were adding phosphate to solution. So that was a unique find. From there, we did our biochar characterization, and we recorded for 25 of the biochars, we recorded the temperature at which they're produced at. And we also recorded their pH with the normal soils pH method. And then we did ultimate and proximate analysis. We measured the carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, hydrogen, sulfur, as well as their ash content, their percent moisture as received. And this is all in dry weights except for that percent moisture, their percent volatile organics, and their fixed carbon. So, and then we did statistical analysis. So we used R, and we did pairwise correlation. And we were using other ways to kind of break down this data because our results were, again, all over the place. So we didn't, well, I'll show you the data first. So here's our correlation matrix. And just to kind of explain it quickly, up in the top left, you have our ammonia, nitrate, and phosphate sorption percentages for just the biochars in general. So there's all the data in each square. And then with the general parameters of all the biochars. And dark blue means that, well, blue means that it's a positive correlation, red is a negative correlation, and darker the color, the higher, the closer the correlation is to 1. So the R-squared value is close to 1. We did statistical tests on this to actually see what was significant. And this is what was left. So everything that's in the X, that's X'd out, it was not statistically significant. And just to kind of focus in on what we're going to look at here, we're going to look at that top section there, and I'll bring it down here. And what we see is really interesting. For ammonia sorption, the only thing that was partially correlated, and I'll show you the numbers in a second, what that R squared value is, was pH for ammonia, which, There are mechanisms that ammonia can be lost because of pH. And then for nitrate, we saw that there's a correlation, a small correlation about 0.4, and these are all about 0.4, 0.3 to 0.5 correlations. With phosphate, with the temperature that the biochar was produced, and that was only an end sample of 25, and then with percent moisture, and I'll talk about that in a second then. And then phosphate, we saw temperature and percent ash, which is interesting too. So what does this mean, or what did we find out really? The big thing that we were finding out is that sorption does not really correlate with any of the biochar backbone structures. And what I wanted to show you guys here is that the carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, hydrogen, and sulfur, they really weren't correlating with anyone's, any of the analytes' sorption, so nitrate, ammonia, or phosphate. And that was interesting because, well, I'll explain that in a second. For ammonia sorption, we saw a correlation of pH, and here's the number. So 0.47 R squared. And just kind of like a hypothesis as to what's happening, we did see that at higher pHs, there was more removal from solution, which could indicate volatilization, just degassing ammonia into the atmosphere. There's also a surface chemistry that plays a role with this because we use just DI water. So we did not pH buffer these solutions. And they can control that. Then the biochar is controlling the pH of the solution. So that's what we saw with ammonia. With nitrate, we saw that temperature correlated slightly with nitrate sorption and percent moisture. Now, when we were looking at this, Kurt and I, we were thinking, well, we're not entirely sure what is happening at this point, but the aromatic structure was an idea that we were thinking about for temperature. With the higher amounts of aromatic structure in carbon, so more graphitic type carbons, you have electrons that can move around the biochar molecule, and maybe nitrate comes in and is able to displace electrons. That's an idea. And then the H2O interaction was not quite, we don't know why that would be. And this could be just something that just came up in our results, and that's not really significant. It's just showing up here. For phosphate, this is something that's a little bit more understandable. So with the greater temperatures, you have higher ash content generally in charcoals. And phosphate sorption might not be sorption at all, and it might be just phosphate precipitation. And what we postulate as a mechanism is that phosphate likes to interact with metal cations in solution. Magnesium, calcium, sodium, sodium and potassium. And this could be the mechanism that we think that phosphate is leaving from solution. And I'll show you a quick, so we're just going to go back to this before I show you some pictures. But for nitrogen, the really big thing to kind of come out of this was that we don't see the carbon backbone structure playing a primary, it's not a primary factor for biochar interaction with ammonia or nitrate. And that's big because that means that the backbone structure is not big, is not important. And what we do see is that the small correlation that exists with different variables is with pH, is with temperature of the biochar produced, and percent H2O moisture. And these are variables that are not in the biochar itself. They're around it. And so this indicates that maybe what we want to do is look more around the biochar than the bulk structure of the biochar for these interactions with ammonia and nitrate. For phosphate, we already know that phosphate precipitates in solution with metal cations, and this phosphorus correlation with the ash content supports this idea. And after our analysis, our experiment, we actually did some SEM EDS photos of some biochars, and what we see is that whenever we see phosphorus, we see that there's always high contents of either magnesium or calcium, and what you see here is that there's magnesium, calcium, sodium, and potassium. Now, some of these are soluble in solution, but calcium is not. And so when we see phosphorus with these types of metals on the biochar, we know that it's indicative of precipitation. So with that, we did come out with biochars that absorbed or removed a lot of ammonia or nitrate or phosphorus. And what we want to do is we want to look at this group of data and maybe pairwise correlation. So break it down. But we haven't done that yet. And what we're going to do is we're going to do surface area analysis, see if that's we're just going to do more analysis of the biochars and see if they correlate with sorption, trying to find out what is driving these interactions. So metal content analysis, we'll add that, so calcium, magnesium. We will do a pH-adjusted experiment to really see if, so from the biochars that removed the most, there was one biochar that was a bituminous charcoal ash that actually removed ammonia and nitrate. And it was really interesting, and it removed a lot of nitrate and some ammonia. And that's two different chemistries that are indicative of going on. So we want to just see if this happens, and this can happen still in soil-like pHs. We'll do FTIR analysis to see if there's functional group chemistry. And the photo on the right is actually an FTIR spectra that's been, I think it's the second derivative spectra in the middle, and that's the original spectra on the top. And what you're seeing is that the peaks tell you what types of functional groups are on top of the surface of the charcoal. And we want to take a look and see what's there before and after. And then we'll do analysis of the state of the sorbed nitrogen and phosphorus. So in conclusion, again, the big thing that we're coming away with this is that the carbon backbone structure is not a primary factor for the biochar sorption interactions for ammonia and nitrate. Environmental factors likely play a stronger role than the bulk structure of the charcoal. And future work will include examining the surface chemistry and the characterization of the state of the nitrogen and phosphorus on the surface of the charcoal. So I'd like to say thank you and acknowledge Kurt's focus and the rest of our lab group.